Portugal's electric company expresses interest to invest in the Philippines. This was discussed during a meeting last week between Manila's energy chief, Rafael Lutilia, with Portugal's visiting foreign minister, João Corvino. Energias de Portugal, or the EDP, says it wants to develop the Philippines' renewable energy capabilities. Lutilia, meanwhile, said Manila wants a cooperation with Portugal on offshore wind and floating solar, hydrogen and ammonia production, and the transition from coal. The Portuguese electric company gets 3/4 of its energy from renewable sources and recently shut down its last coal plants. Finance Secretary Ben Diokno allaying fears the proposed merger of Land Bank of the Philippines and the Development Bank of the Philippines will lead to a super monopoly. Diokno previously said the move to combine the two state-run lenders would make it the biggest bank of the country in terms of assets. He's defending the move, saying there's a strong economic argument for the merger.
The merger is sound on the basis of the argument, you right size, and that you have economies of scale. Mm-hmm. And as you know, the financials of DBP is a little bit shaky. They are asking for additional 100 billion infusion, right, from the national government. Mm-hmm. And so I think the merger will be a good move. And so we have, it will be more efficient, and we will be able to increase the loanable funds as a result of the merger. There are so many other banks. In other countries, there are only 5 banks. Here, we have more than 30 plus big banks, right? Mm-hmm. So it cannot be a super monopoly.
Diokno also says the merger will carry on despite a looming Senate investigation into its supposed risks. Now, the Philippines and India will continue to be the fastest-growing economies in the Asia-Pacific this year. That rosy outlook coming from Moody's Analytics, which sees a 6% growth for both countries in 2023, thanks to a strong labor market and upbeat consumer demand. That forecast falls within government's target range of 6 to 7% growth. For Finance Secretary Benjamin Diokno, the optimistic forecasts prove the Philippine economy has a good standing in the global stage.
He's encouraged to go around the world and talk about the Philippines because it's really a different Philippines. Okay, we have a nice story to tell.
It's can a you imagine, different Philippines.
Yeah, can you imagine if you have. We were in the same situation as before. You have nothing. You can go out and talk about something, but nobody will believe you. From Korea, Kino.
You're
and
right.
Then Arab, and then Duterte, and then you know, each president faces a different challenge, okay? And so I've seen the ups and downs of the Philippine economy. It was very challenging during the Duterte Aquino years. Now, I keep saying this is our moment. Okay, all the stars are aligned. Our macroeconomic fundamentals are sound. Banking system is sound.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. recently brought home some $285 million in investment pledges from his state visit to Malaysia. His administration will also lead the resumption of free trade agreement talks with the European Union.
China vowing to boost credit to private companies and extend other funding measures to small firms. This as policymakers seek ways to shore up confidence and support the country's recovery. Beijing will expand a bond credit enhancement tool that is backed by financial institutions to all qualified private companies. The policy had mainly been used to help cash-strapped property developers raise funds from the bond market. Chinese firms have been holding back from investing or hiring as the local economy deals with challenges from a property slump to growing unemployment among the youth. The Reserve Bank of Australia keeps interest rates unchanged at 4.1% for a second month. The RBA says the pause is meant to provide the central bank more time to assess the impact of previous rate hikes. This comes as inflation in Australia slowed to 6% in the second quarter, down from 7% in the first 3 months of the year. Australian Central Bank has hiked interest rates by a cumulative 400 basis points since May last year, to its highest in 11 years. Tuesday's RBI policy meeting is Philip Lowe's penultimate meeting as governor. Michelle Bullock is set to succeed him on September 17th. Fresh factory activity data in focus in Asia today, starting with the Chinese Keqin manufacturing PMI swinging to contraction last month. The private sector survey showed the figure at 49.2% in its first decline since April. In Japan, factory activity contracted at a faster pace as firms take a hit from soft orders amid weaker global demand. We're also seeing South Korea and Australia's PMI staying in contraction territory. In contrast, Philippine factories picked up pace last month. The country's PMI stood 51.9 in what S&P Global said indicated stronger operating conditions at the start of the third quarter. A look now at how financial markets traded on the first day of the month. Major indices in the Asia-Pacific region were mixed as investors assessed China's latest PMI. The Chinese market settling in the red on Tuesday. The Hang Seng took a hit as Hong Kong's economy expanded less than expected in the second quarter. The Nikkei 225, meanwhile, was up nearly 8% as Japan's unemployment rate fell to 2.5% in June. In terms of share price movements, Country Garden's shares in Hong Kong dropped by 7%. That's following reports the Chinese real estate developer scrapped its plan for a $300 million primary share placement. Let's take a look now at futures in Europe. They are pointing to a flat open on the first trading day of August as investors await key earnings and manufacturing data in the region. HSBC shares in focus after Europe's largest bank announced a $2 billion buyback after reporting strong first-half profit and revenue. Over on Wall Street, futures are flat as well ahead of a busy week of earnings. On the lineup, pharmaceutical giants Pfizer and Merck, as well as Caterpillar and Uber.
Time for some local corporate stories. Asia United Bank sees its net income jumping to 4.1 billion pesos in the first half of the year. The Robisco Group's banking arm points to higher business volume and net interest margin for the 42% growth year-on-year. In the second quarter alone, AUB booked a 2.1 billion peso net income, up 32% from last year. Meanwhile, 8990 Holdings says its revenues have reached pre-pandemic levels. Its total revenues last year came in at 21.64 billion pesos, higher than the 20.36 billion pesos in 2021. Net profit was also up to 7.65 billion pesos. This year, the company says it's earmarking some 8 billion pesos in capital expenditures to fund expansion efforts.
In today's numbers that matter, 1 billion pesos, that's the year-long budget allotted for the compensation of residents whose properties were either damaged or destroyed by the Marawi City siege in 2017. But that amount was nearly wiped out on the first day of processing of claims. Now, the Marawi Compensation Board is asking for more funds. As of August 1st, around 12,000 are booked to file their claims for compensation until March 2024.
Traveling can be one of life's greatest joys, but trying to find your way in another country, especially if you don't speak the same language, can be daunting. In Tokyo, one rail line is breaking down those barriers with the use of a face-to-face translation screen. The device allows visitors and a station attendant to converse, while the semi-transparent display spells out words in Japanese and one of 11 other languages, including English, French, Mandarin, and Spanish. It's currently on a three-month trial before the company considers a wider rollout. Think tank Ibon Foundation doubts if government will achieve its target of below 2% inflation rate by the first quarter of next year. Its executive director, Sunny Africa, says government should take measures to address basic demands of Filipinos instead of just hoping that inflation will ease. This, he says, can be achieved through wage increases and cutting interest rates.
Even if inflation moderates, if they're not seeing increases in their incomes and earnings, just to take a case on wages, they will not be able to cope up with higher prices. It's creeping death for them. And I think that slow decline in purchasing power is something that the government has to help with additional cash assistance, while also, very perplexing for us, increasing the agriculture response, the food supply response. But again, despite the president supposedly being hands-on on the agricultural department, we're not seeing any major supply response in terms of cheaper food.